Now, we've reached the semi-final stage of Euro 2020, and it has been, I think, fascinating for football fans. Too many teams in it, some disgraceful decisions by UEFA to make Wales and Switzerland, indeed Denmark and the Czech Republic as well, fly all the way to Baku, which is in Azerbaijan. I don't know what that has to do with football in Europe. It's a terrible, terrible game. And the reasons why these things happen, you couldn't, without breaking the laws of libel, explain. Nevertheless, England's particular journey, they played all their matches at Wembley. In fact, all the semi-finalists, England, Spain, Italy and Denmark, all had their three opening games in their own country, in their own capital cities. And maybe it's no coincidence that they're the teams that got to the semi-final. It doesn't in any way detract from what they've achieved, of course, but the unfairness built into the tournament, I think, is worth noting. And I'm joined now by John Giles to look at the teams who are in the semi-final and to look back a little bit at how they got to the semi-final. John?
Can I just interrupt you there? England played in Rome.
Oh, they played in Rome Saturday night, yep. That's their one away game. Thanks very much for that. The game in Rome, of course, against Ukraine, which you could play Ukraine anywhere, John, I think the state they were in. Because they had played against Sweden. They had gone to extra time. And Denmark, of course, had to go to extra time as well. And I figure they'll be pretty tired by the time they take the pitch against England on Wednesday. But first, tomorrow, there's a really intriguing match between Italy and Spain. But John, let's look at Italy and Spain, and particularly we were talking to each other while we watched Italy and Belgium on Friday night.
Yeah.
The Italians really have impressed both of us, I think. Spain, less so. But Belgium are the team that never really delivers, do they? And again, on Saturday night, or Friday night, rather, it seems that De Bruyne, Kevin De Bruyne, is saying now he played with damage to his ankle ligaments, and I think he may well have done, but he didn't contribute much throughout the tournament, whether it was tiredness or what. Lukaku scored a couple of goals early on, but they never really deliver on their promise, Belgium, do they?
No, not when it gets to the vital stages near the end, Eamon. And De Bruyne didn't play well at all. I think he did have an ankle injury.
Yes, I think he did too.
And he didn't play well at all. Belgium didn't play well at all. They were disappointing in the match. I think probably the team have gone past their best, Eamon.
Yeah.
But they've never really delivered before with the players they had and the expectations that they never delivered on them. So, Italy beat them, deserved to beat them, Eamon.
And the Italians really, I mean, Mancini's done a fantastic job, but really no big stars in the team. Insigne and Immobile, their two strikers, are okay, but by the standards of Rossi and people who have played in the past for Italy, not great. They still have Chiellini at the back, he's fantastic, he loves it, and you'd have to admire him. They seem to have a very good goalkeeper, John, but what do you make of the job Mancini's done?
Well, he's done a fantastic job, Eamon. You know, I mean, he's gone 32 matches on, and that takes a bit of doing in any international team.
Yeah.
And I think he's changed them in a big, big way, Eamon.
Yeah.
In the Italian teams that we're used to And it was a perfect example on the Belgium match. When they went a goal in front in the first minute, they defend for 89 minutes.
Yeah.
Now, that has changed. In his team, when they go a goal in front, they're not sitting back now, Eamon.
Yeah.
They're getting forward. They're having a goal. Like, I think it's changed them totally in the manner with the history of the game.
Yes.
And the way they've played for years. And I think it's good. And obviously good for them in what they're doing. I mean, they've got the midfield of Jorginho.
Yeah, Verratti is a very good
Verratti,
player.
Good players. Now, I think he's changed Jorginho from his Chelsea way of playing.
Yeah, very much
he's more progressive. He's looking ahead. He's an influence of the game an awful lot more. And that's, I think, is down to Mancini and telling them, this is what I want from you. Yeah. And from the rest of the players. I mean, they've still got, as you say, they've got the Cellini and Bonucci at the back. I mean, they're getting on a bit, but they're still doing their job. They've got a good goalkeeper as well.
Yeah, very good goalkeeper, I think, yeah.
So they've got all the basics there. A bit unlucky that they lost their left-back the other day.
Yeah, it's Spinazzola.
And, you know, he's a really good player.
Yeah, he's a right-footed left fullback. Spinazzola is his name. And about an hour into the game against Belgium, he jumped for a ball, landed. Like a lot of players, John, he looks... He's not going to be able to play any more football. I think he did ligaments as well. A lot of players going down in all the matches, but he is a big loss, isn't he?
Oh, it's a huge loss. He's been a very, very good player for them. So they've been impressive in the way. I don't think they have the players, the type of players or the great players that they've had in the past. But I think, again, Mancini, he's encouraged them to do what they're doing, Eamon. They're not sitting back, which is a big change for them.
Yep.
I think he's urging Jorginho to be more aggressive or looking forward more.
And he's also he's working harder to get the ball back as well, John, than he does.
As well, you know, like you see, that's what managers do, Eamon. Good managers do. They get the best from players who haven't been doing it. And that's what he's done. The only doubts about them is that they don't really have a recognised goal scorer.
No, but they're coming from all of them. Barella has scored goals. Chiesa, your man, who you picked out, and he was a starter on Saturday night. He didn't start Friday night, brother. He didn't start in their previous game. Came on as a sub, and I think scored. So they have got these players that we really don't know because they're not stars and they're not playing for star clubs.
Yeah, well, but that's the only fault I would find with them. Like, England have Kane, well, Kane has come on to it, and other teams have recognised goal scorers.
Yeah.
I don't see that with Italy, but as long as they keep chipping in, they're okay. They'll take a lot of beating, Eamon. I think they've a good attitude, they defend well, they're attacking now in a way when they have the ball that they didn't do traditionally. So they're not going to be an easy team to beat, that's for sure.
No, and there was a moment in the Belgium match, just a minute before half-time actually, Insigne scored a fabulous goal, John, and really wanted it too. He picked the ball up about 40 yards out, a little bit wide, cut inside and curled one past Courtois. It was just one of those real memorable moments, a very important moment as well, but a great, great goal. So they do have it, but it's not. It's based on the work ethic and the team ethic as well. And you can see it even... I know this might sound silly, but when they're singing the national anthem, John, I mean, Chiellini, they're belting it out, all of them. It's like, I'm looking forward, if they get to Wembley, which I hope they do, to play England. I mean, the English lads are giving God Save the Queen some welly. So it'll be very interesting to see.
See who wins the choir, Eamon.
Yeah.
Who's the best choir?
Now, but, sorry, John, go on.
Yeah, no. I think they're very, very good, Eamon. I think they'd be even better, obviously, like most teams, if they had an outstanding goal scorer. But they are coming from different people, and they've done really well. There's no doubt about that. And I think they'll if they get to the final with England, I think it'll be a hell of a match, Eamon. And they'd give any team a big game. That's for sure.
Yeah, and Spinazzola won't be playing, and he's a big miss.
Yes,
but there's no doubt about that. But I just want to ask you about that semi-final between Italy and Spain. I think that Spain don't think they're as good round the pitch, and I don't really think they have a goal scorer either. In fact, Morata has had a bit of a nightmare. They play with less energy than Italy, and I thought against Croatia, where they had to go to extra time, allowing Croatia to come back from 3-1 down, 3-all. Another magnificent performance by our favourite player for Croatia. You know, it's Luka Modric. It's just, they don't have it. I couldn't see Croatia coming back from 3-1 down against Italy.
No, they did well to do it again. Our friend Modric is brilliant, Eamon. I put them down as when I've seen them tippy tappy.
Yeah.
You know, they've got obviously got some terrific players, but like young Pedri is going to be a very good player. They've got Busquets in the middle of the field. But they're not encouraged to turn on the ball and get forward from certain positions, like the Italians have been definitely be doing under their manager. You know, they get there, they come back, and it's tippy. You know, I think it's tippy tappy. It goes across the pitch. And situations where they should be really getting at the goal, the opposing goal, they're passing it backwards. That's the way I see them. Now, obviously, they've got some very, very good players, Eamon, but I think I can't see them beating Italy.
No, and a couple of them, you mentioned Busquets there. He's 34 at least. Jordi Alba, who's captain in the team, he's left back. He's been a wonderful player for Spain and for Barcelona. But also, he's cracking on. I can see Italy. I think Italy win the match, John. I'm sure you will see Italy put them under pressure because they do press Italy, and they do.
Oh yeah, that's what they're doing now, Eamon.
Yeah,
that they haven't done historically.
No,
you know, this is the first Italian team I've ever seen do that.
Yeah,
and it's paying off for them.
Yeah.
Now whether they get the goal score or not, I fancy them to beat Spain. I'm looking forward to it. I think it'll be a really, really good game that.
Yeah, and that's Tuesday night's game and Wednesday night. Now there's a game to relish or savour. England at home at Wembley playing Denmark in a semi final to get to a final. It's really the first time since 1966, not 1066. And the Danes will be very tired. They had a hard game in Baku against the Czech Republic at the weekend. They're down Christian Eriksen, although their relationship with each other as a group with their own fans is amazing. They have been really inspired. I couldn't see them, John, could you, putting up a real fight against England? But maybe that's to seriously underestimate them.
I think they'll put up a fight, Eamon. I think they'll put up a good fight. You know, I think they have the what I'm calling it, the spirit of Christian Eriksen.
Yes.
It's definitely there, Eamon. And they're a close-knit bunch by the looks of it. And they really have played. And they've got some fair players, Eamon, as we know. You know, you've got Schmeichel, Holberg, Delaney, Christensen, Dahlberg.
Yeah, they are good.
That's the guy. You know, they're a workman-like team that can cause an upset. I know you're not writing them off. Nobody's writing them off. But they're second favourites, that's for sure. But they have this spirit going for them that's worth an awful lot, Eamon, as we know, in the game. And they'll give England a game. I fancy England to beat them, but I think they might give them a fright.
Okay. Now let's talk about England and Gareth Southgate, John. We had an interesting conversation at the weekend in which we both said that we wouldn't have played Raheem Sterling and we wouldn't have played two holding midfield players, even though Phillips is a Leeds player and we know you've got a soft spot for that. We wouldn't have played Rice and Phillips as a pair. We'd never have started Kieran Trippier left back for the first game and all the lots of other things that we might not have done. Now, Gareth Southgate, as I commented in my piece in the Daily Star today, he's either going to end up with his face in the middle of a turnip if they get a bad result, or he'll be Sir Gareth Southgate. And we did both agree. First of all, I want you to confirm that I haven't misrepresented you. Secondly, we both saw an echo of 1966 when Alf Ramsey was very critical. People were very critical of him for being too conservative, too defensive, very, very reminiscent of Gareth Southgate's treatment by many people, former players and indeed journalists in this tournament.
Yeah, well that's what you get, Eamon. You know what I mean? That's the game.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I mean, we don't agree with it, but that's the game. Look at Harry Kane. Now, Harry Kane is a hero again, Eamon.
Ah, yeah. You would never have taken him off, would you?
No. I think that was a bad decision to make.
Yeah.
In Southgate's place. I think Southgate is a good lad, Eamon.
Yes.
I think he's really good. I think his PR is very, very good.
He's a decent guy.
He's a decent guy, definitely. Now, I think on the football side, Eamon, first of all, I think he's blessed He has a very, very, very good group of players.
Yes.
A very good group of players. I mean, if you take what he did at the start of the first match, he played two fullbacks, and the second match he played two different fullbacks.
Yes.
Well, I think that was tactics, and I think it was bad tactics.
Yes.
But he wasn't doing any harm, because he was leaving two good fullbacks out.
And bringing two
even better fullbacks.
Yeah.
Right. And again, if you look at the Sterling, definitely I wouldn't have played at all. I think he did really well on that, because
yes.
I think Sterling's having a nightmare from City from Christmas onwards. He didn't kick a ball for him. I wouldn't have played him at all.
Yes.
And he's probably been the best, most important player.
Oh, he has.
So far in it. I mean,
yeah.
But I've just written down on the players he has at his disposal. I don't want to bore you with it. But in the goalkeepers, Pickford, Pope, Henderson.
Yeah.
Right? Fullbacks, Trippier, Walker, Shaw, Chilwell. Chilwell hasn't played yet, and I think he's the best of them.
Yeah.
Centre back, Stones, Maguire, Mings, Cody.
Yeah.
Right. And now, in the big way, right, midfield, Rice, Phillips, Henderson, and can put in that position, I mean, Grealish, Mount,
yeah,
and Bellingham. Bellingham.
Incredible. Right?
They all can play in that position.
Yeah.
And up front, you got Kane, Sterling, Foden, Rashford, Saka, Sancho.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. There's nobody in this competition, Eamon, has that quality of player.
No, that's
so
right.
No matter what he does, he's gonna be really, 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 really bad manager if he makes a mistake in picking the teams, which is the most important thing of the lot.
Yes, and he did. I mean, I think he took the view, John, clean sheet is huge. And they've kept their clean sheet, even though Scotland also kept a clean sheet against them. And that was a night I thought could have gone pear-shaped for him. And but the thing about, well, you've been an international manager. I were for 7 years, and you managed very successfully in England as well. Now, club management is very different, John, isn't it? The international team management, they're not your players. You have them for a limited period of time. The pressures, particularly on England, from the media and indeed from fans, are terrible. So you've not much going for you, have you?
Well, you have the players going for you, Eamon.
Yes, if you get them.
Right. And
they appear
to... players, that's the most important thing of the lot.
Yeah.
And nowadays, you do have enough time with the players to do what's needed to be done.
Yeah. Well,
right.
Certainly at a major tournament, yeah.
At a major tournament. He's had them for a few weeks. Now, what I don't agree with, and this is only my take on football, Eamon, I think what you have to do is to get to know your best team as soon as you possibly can.
Yes.
Your best team.
Yes.
Because football, I mean, I've spoken to you about this, well, not you, anybody, about football is made up of a million things.
Yep.
And the first thing you come to as a manager is the conclusion, what are my best team? And then you play that team as often as you possibly can.
Yes.
Right, because football is made of a million different. Nobody gets it perfect all the time. You play a match, you'll find something that's gone wrong, you put it right. You play the next match. And the more matches you play, the better you should get.
Yes.
Right.
Yep.
Now, they're my principles on it, for what it's worth. Now, in Southgate's case, he did the opposite to that, Eamon.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
He played the first match, I don't know whether it was his best team or not, but he played them with the two fullbacks that we didn't agree with. One was at left-back with Trippier.
Trippier, right-footed left-back, and not like Spinazzola in Italy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right, so for the next match, he's got two different back four altogether.
Yes.
Right. Now, I don't agree with that at all. That's a wing and a prayer.
Yes.
Because you don't know what to expect from those players. If you haven't played with them time after time after time to put things right.
Yep.
If you played the first match, the second match, you're putting nothing right from the first match, Eamon.
Yep.
Really. So that's my take on it. But for what he is, what he has, and I said at the start, he's got excellent players to be able to leave the two fullbacks out, which should be his best fullbacks, for two fullbacks in the second match that were probably better.
Yeah.
And the same in midfield, Eamon. He's got Grealish, he's got all players up front that can play in different positions.
Yeah.
So even in the I don't think they've got a creative midfield player, but with the two players that he has, he's got like Foden and Sancho, and they just give it to them.
Yes.
And Sterling.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I don't think I give him credit for what he's done. I think he's created a good spirit in the team. Definitely keeps it good. And he's a good lad, and his PR is very, very good. I would question some of the things he does on the pitch. But I think, no matter what I think they're favourites to win this particular competition with the group of players that he has playing for him now.
Yeah, I mean, one of the most extraordinary things is Raheem Sterling. He has had, as you pointed out, a really poor season, to the point where it's been leaked to the press that Pep Guardiola is prepared to sell him and wants to sell him. He didn't feature much in the vital closing stages of the Premier League run, or indeed in the Champions League games.
He was terrible in the final, Eamon. Well, he was terrible since Christmas, Eamon.
Yeah.
He was dreadful.
Yeah.
So he must have been saving himself for this particular competition.
Well, no, what's really interesting is that he has made a major contribution. He scored three goals. He made the first goal on Saturday night, which I thought was huge.
Yeah.
And he made it with a very clever pass. He cut inside and played Harry Kane through. His brain was functioning, and he played Harry Kane through 1-0 up. So again, he made a major contribution. And also, in games where they needed an injection of pace and tempo, he was the one who was injecting the pace and tempo, even when he wasn't scoring or making goals.
This
is remarkable.
There's no doubt, Eamon. He's been England's best player.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about that. He's scored the goals when they were really, really needed, and he's making them as well. So his attitude has been great.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about that. That wasn't his attitude for City.
No, absolutely. No. Something's gone wrong there, clearly, now.
Definitely. But good luck to Southgate. He's getting the best from him. He's not bothered about how he's playing for City,
no,
quite rightly. And he's getting the best out of him, which is obviously good management.
We should point out as well that Gareth Southgate might be on his way to being Sir Gareth. Mm. He is certainly a credit to football in the way that he conducts himself. Mm. There's no slagging of players, and you can see the way the players pour off the bench when England score, that they're all in it together in a very, very big way. Let's remember how he got the job, John. Your favourite manager, Sam Allardyce, was appointed. He played one game, and then he got caught in a media sting when he was just mouthing off about how to manipulate something or other. Anyway, had to resign. Now they were looking for a manager. And Gareth Southgate was managing the under-21s. And he would be, I think, when we're speaking unkindly of Gareth Southgate, and I know I certainly have, he'd be the kind of guy that would tick all the boxes for the suits in the Football Association. And, of course, they gave him the job. And really, his managerial CV wasn't great. But life is strange, isn't it?
Can happen in football, as you know.
And, yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't give the officials great credit for picking him, Eamon, because they picked Sam Allardyce before him.
Yeah.
So that's you know, even the stop clock is right twice a day. So they got that right eventually. But I think the biggest thing of the lot for him, I think he's a good lad and I like him, Eamon. I think he's a decent individual.
Yes.
But I think he's blessed to get the players that he has at his disposal at the moment.
Yeah, and the just...
good luck to him. If he makes the best and wins the competition, where I think he will, now they're favourites now.
Yeah.
Good luck to him. And if he gets his knighthood, good luck to him.
Yeah, absolutely. It was just a final...
There's been worse people got knighthoods, Eamon, than him.
There sure was. There was just one thing I was going to ask you, and it's about Jadon Sancho.
Yeah.
I thought he was really fascinating on Saturday night, Saturday. He was fearless. He was desperate to get the ball. He just looked the real deal. Now, Manchester United are going to have his services next year, and I know you don't make the kind of snap judgments that I make, but nevertheless, I think he will be a massive asset. He looks full of brains, full of confidence, and has a very, very high technical skill level.
I want to see more of him, Eamon.
No, that's absolutely right.
I thought he was good. I thought he was good, but it's the first time I've seen him.
Yeah.
And he was playing. Wasn't he playing on Saturday when they were well on top, Eamon?
Who? Yeah.
Sancho. Yeah. You know, was No, but was he playing? He wasn't playing against one of the top teams, was he yet?
No. Well, no, he hasn't. No, it was just...
No. Look, I liked what I saw of him.
Yes, it was only the Ukraine. That's fair enough. It was only the Ukraine, but it was just something about him that looked impressive.
Yeah, I was impressed with him.
Right.
But that's as far as I would go with him.
Right.
I want to see a lot more of him to know he's the real McCoy. But he looks very promising, that's for sure.
Okay, John. So just get you to confirm that for you, the two semifinals, Italy to beat Spain, England to beat Denmark, after possibly a fright. And for me, Italy to beat Spain and England to take advantage of the fact that the Danes might be very, very tired. They've had a long trip to Baku, and that all they've achieved, and it's been terrific for them as a group. It may leave them a bit legless at Wembley on Wednesday, and we see Italy and England in the final. I'm very grateful to you, John, for joining us. As all our listeners are, and we'll talk to you after the semi-final to find out if England are going to bring it home, John.
It's going well for them at the moment, Damon, that's for sure.
Okay, we're very grateful to John Giles, to all of you for listening.